Good morning, church. Good morning. It's so good to see all of you. I don't know, when I grew up in church, we would say something like, God is good, and then you say, and then all the time.
God is good.
Let's try that. See if we can do that again. We gotta repeat it. God is good.
All the time.
And then all the time.
God is good.
Mom, you should know it. You grew up in Yeah, so welcome. The word of God says to enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. So I want us all to think about, like, there's something that we're thankful for today. That even if it's, you had a rough day, a rough week, you got up this morning, you're here to worship the Lord, that there is something that you can be thankful for. You can be thankful for the breath in your lungs. You can be thankful for your family. You can be thankful that you have people that love you. And God gives us all of these things. So I want us to just think about that as we enter this atmosphere to worship him. He is worthy to be praised. He is worthy to be worshiped. That even when we don't acknowledge him, he still sees us, he still loves us, he still wants to have a relationship with us and be with us. Let's open our hearts today to receive what the Lord has for us. Let's open our hearts today to worship him and give him the glory that is due his name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Thank you, God. Just thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for the sun. Thank you for the wind. Thank you for the heat, God. It's been raining for months. I'm glad that we have sunshine again, Lord. I thank you just for bringing us here in this place, God. I thank you that you've brought us all together from various places, various backgrounds, various situations, God. And we set aside that this time to worship you, God. We set aside this time to hear from your word. We set aside this time to honor you, God. You have been so good to us and so faithful. You love us and you care for us more than we could ever know. And so I pray, Lord, that we would lay those things that are on our minds. We lay those things at your feet today. We lay those things at your cross, knowing that you defend us, knowing that you take care of us, knowing that you hold the world in your hands, and that you will give us the perfect peace, and know that you will take care of all those things that concern us. We love you, and we give you all the praise and the honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God goes before us. He fights for us. In every battle, every season, he is there. Let's rest in that truth today. Amen.
of you now. now than ever. Give us more of you, Jesus. Make your presence known. Make it known with us, Lord. Make your Holy Spirit rain down upon us to be strong and spread your word. To let the whole world know out there that our God exists. And that we're going to get more of Him. And more of Him. And more of Him. Because we can't do it alone, church. So ask Him to come into your life and just be there for you. Let your cup overflow with His love. Oh, Father God, we need more and more of you, Jesus. Oh, Father God, I pray that you are in this place and that you give yourself to each and every one of us here. Oh, Father God, we love you. We love you with all our heart, Lord. We love you with all our soul. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you do. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I thank you. God, you're in this place. And we just ask you that you be over our pastor as he delivers the word of God to you. And that everyone in the congregation opens up their hearts to whatever it is that Jesus is telling them to listen to it, to follow it, to act upon it, to serve him, serve the church together as one with you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, we're so thankful that we are in this place.
Thank you, Jesus.
We're thankful for the independence you gave us as a country, Lord. And this country to be freely worshiping the one true God, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
We take that for granted, Jesus, and let us not. We live in a country where we can freely worship you.
Thank you, Jesus.
We can freely hear the word of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
We can freely submit to you.
Yes.
Oh, Jesus, we pray for this country. We pray for this country, Lord. We pray that you manifest in it and you are at the head of it, Lord. That in God we trust, Lord. And in only God we trust, the one true God who died and rose again from the grave, Lord. Who died and rose again from the grave, Lord. Who gave us the Holy Spirit as a gift, even though we are not worthy, Lord. But Jesus, say it and I will. Oh, Father God, we thank you for letting us join you here today. We thank you for letting us hear your word. And we thank you for being in the presence of worship.
Thank you, Jesus.
Because this church gives it all to you, Jesus. It's all about Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
He is our cornerstone.
Yes, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
And Father God, we just ask you to continue to bless each and every one of us that are here. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Stand up and greet somebody today. Good morning, church.
speaking for the children right now. You have a seat. Oh, what's up with that? Oh, you know, yeah. Amen. We'll just pray for you guys. Father, we just thank you for these children which you have blessed us with. We pray, Father, that your spirit would be upon them, that you, Father, would move through them. We thank you, Father, for their teacher, and that out of her would flow rivers of living water, and that you would bless her as she serves these blessings in which you have given us.
Yes.
And so we thank you, Father, for this time in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right then. Oh, we got blankets back there. All right. Well, welcome, welcome, welcome. Let us all, I always like to start out with a word of prayer. Father, we just thank you just for the privilege and opportunity to be here in your presence, that you would move in a mighty way, that you would be glorified in all that we say and all that we do, that you would move in our lives and in our hearts to shape us and mold us, to be fashioned into the image of your dear Son. And so we thank you for this day, because this is a day that you have given us, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, as always, I just thank the Lord for the privilege and opportunity to be able to share the Word of God with you. It is, again, by His grace and mercy that I have this privilege. And I always want to read out of 1 Peter 4:11, which says, if anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. And if anyone serve, let him serve by the strength which God supplies, so that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belong the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Well, for the past few weeks, we have been studying the church at Ephesus. And I tend to fixate on certain things. So I kind of like fixated on one of the passages here. And I just want to expound on it a little bit more. So just bear with me. This is out of Ephesians 2, verses 8 through 10. It says, by grace you have been saved through faith, and not that of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Other translations talk about that last verse where it says we should walk in them. It talks about taking the paths in which he has set. Another translation would read, so that we would walk in what he has given us. So me, I think that there are paths. God has a path for us. God has a destiny for us. He has a purpose for our lives. And there is a path in which he says, I want you to walk in this path, which I have given you, that I have set before you. And there is an enemy that wants us to confuse us as to the path that God wants us on. And he's happy with if we don't walk on the path, if we walk in disobedience or if we do our own thing, he's good with that. Because as long as he can stray us from what God has for us, then we're never able to reach the potential which God has. Now, in my devotion, I was reading Psalm 37. Just the Lord just kind of spoke to me in this, where it says, the steps, this is Psalm 37, starting with verse 23. It says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. And he, this is the Lord, delights in his way. And though he fall, he will not utterly be cast down, for the Lord upholds them with his hand. So there is this path, this way in which God delights in, I'm walking in. Now, it kind of like indicates God is happy or God is delighted when I'm walking in what he has for me. It is something that just, it pleases him. Now, as a parent, and parents can relate, when we have our children, when they're walking in the path that is, you know, that is productive and healthy and leads to wholeness, what do? We're kind of delighted. We're happy when we see our children's successful when we see them being productive and we get such a thrill out of it and we get excited and happy and we talk about it. And I think that's the type of delight that God has when he sees us walking in what he has for us. On the flip side, when our children take a path that is destructive and harmful, what we grieve behind it. We are saddened by the direction that they have taken. Now, I've talked to several Christian parents, and what really kind of like impacts them is that they raise their children to know the Lord, and then these children take a path that is different. They even take a path where they abandon their faith. And when you look at their face, when you talk to them, there is a grief that is tangible. There's a grief that is palatable because they see their children walking in a way knowing that it is a destructive way. And what do? We grieve behind it. We are saddened by it. And I think sometimes when we have a path that we go in and our way, we want to do our thing, I think it might grieve the Lord. Now, it doesn't mean we love our children any less. We love them no matter what path that they take. But the path that they take can either bring delight to us or it can bring grief. But it doesn't impact our love for our children. And we love them in spite of. And I think the Lord loves us in spite of the path that we might take. I believe that the Lord grieves. Ephesians chapter 4, starting with verse 29. We'll read this. It says, "Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers." Talking about what we say. "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." Verse 31. "And let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice." And that word grief, it means to cause sadness. It means to cause sorrow. So I think according to the things that we say and the things that we do, it can grieve the Lord. It doesn't mean that he loves us any less, but I believe that it just causes him sorrow when we're going in the direction that is not what he has for us. And I think that's like, I'm just imposing my parental feelings in this, because as parents, when we see the children walking their way that is productive, we go, oh, we're all excited and proud. But when they don't, they grieve. We grieve for them because we know that it is a path that is going to lead toward destruction. And we pray for them and we intercede for them. But just as we can, I think, grieve the Lord in the things that we say and the things that we do, we can also bring the Lord delight in walking in his path and walking this path of freedom that he has for us, because it does include freedom. John 8, verses 31 through 32 says that this is Jesus speaking. So Jesus said to those Jews who had believed in him, "If you abide in my word, hold fast to my teachings, and live in accordance with them, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and what? The truth will set you free." John 8:36 says this, "If the Son makes you free, then you are unquestionably free." And we learned last week that the Lord has delivered us out of darkness. He's delivered us from the shadow of death. He has broken our chains, the things that shackle us, the things that bind us. This path that God has for us is a path of freedom. It's a path that we're not bound and shackled. We're not walking in the darkness. Now, it says we can walk in this path and please him, but we're going to stumble. In other words, we're going to make mistakes. Even when we try our best, guess what? We can make mistakes. But he says God lifts us up. So we know that when we walk in that path that we're going to stumble, but there's going to be some opposition. There's going to be something that is going to try to keep us in walking in the path that God has for us. Now I want to talk, and we're going to read a passage of scripture, and this is from the Apostle Paul. Now within the context of what is happening, the Apostle Paul, he is writing this letter to the Corinthians, and he's talking about how these people are addressing his apostleship. In other words, they're challenging his authority, and they're just bad-mouthing Paul. They're just saying, oh yeah, when you read his letters, he's talking all bold and real hard, but when you see him in person, he's a wimp. And that sounds like social media. You ever talk about seeing social media? People in social media, they get all bold. They get all bold. They say what they want. But when you see them face to face, it comes, oh, no, I didn't mean all that. So what he saw, so Paul is addressing these lies that people are spreading about him. And then this is where we get this context of this scripture. Because if we listen to a lie long enough, if we convince ourselves that this lie is the truth, it is at that point it can become a stronghold. 2 Corinthians 10, verses 4 or 5. We're going to look at it two translations. One, this is going to be out the New Living Translation. You should have it in your notes. For we use God's mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down the strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. We destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. Out of the Amplified, same passage. For the weapons of our warfare are not physical weapons of flesh and blood, but they are mighty before God for the overthrow and the destruction of strongholds. Inasmuch as we refute arguments and theories and reasonings and every proud and lofty thing that sets itself against the true knowledge of God, and we lead every thought and purpose away captive into the obedience of Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. Now, a lot of this, I was listening to this minister, David Hernandez, and so I gleaned a lot from what he was talking about. Now, what Paul is trying to create in this passage is that when he's talking about a stronghold, he's saying a fortress, and he wants to give you the image of a fortress. And in that time, they would have understood, okay, then, what is a fortress? What surrounds a fortress? Walls. And around those walls, they would determine as to who comes in and what they let out. So they would have what watchmen standing on the walls, and on these walls, they would say, okay, then, friend, let them in. Foe, we don't let them in. So the walls determine what comes in and what comes out. And they surround the city. And this is the image that he is saying. When he's talking about a stronghold, he is talking about a wall that surrounds a city. Now, this stronghold, what is the stronghold in this passage? What are they? Arguments, theories, reasonings. And it essentially what we think, what we reason, our opinion. And sometimes what we think can become a stronghold, and it determines what we let in. And the strongholds, a stronghold is built on deception. And for a deception to be effective, the person that doesn't have to know, they have to be deceived. Nobody says, oh, I'm being deceived. No. What they're saying, what deception is that we don't know that it takes place in our life. That's the power of deception. We don't know. We think it is actually the truth. And when we think it's the truth, it becomes a pattern in how we think. And when it becomes a pattern in how we think, then automatically, unbeknowing to ourselves, we build up walls preventing us from knowing God in a deeper way by the way in which we think. That is the stronghold that is built, that we build around ourselves. Give you examples. I have a right to be bitter. I have every right to be bitter. And we build upon that, and it becomes what? A stronghold. Or I am totally justified in embracing unforgiveness. And what does that become? It becomes a stronghold. And no matter what a person might say, if we have a stronghold, we determine what comes in and what we receive. Or we might say, you know, I am not worthy of the love of the Lord. Or my what I've done is not, I cannot think about him ever forgiving, and I'm deserving of being punished. And what is that? That becomes a stronghold in our thinking so that we can't receive everything that God has for us. And we beat ourselves up every day, every minute of the day, saying, oh, I'm not this. How can I be that? And I used to do that all the time. And it served as a stronghold. And what it does is that this stronghold sets itself against the true knowledge of God. My wife and I, we, along with another couple, were counseling this other couple who was in distress. Their marriage was in jeopardy. Now, between my wife and I and this other couple, we had at least 60 years of experience in which we brought to bear to counsel this couple. But one person in the couple did not want to receive what we had to say. In other words, they knew better than us. They had been married all of about maybe a couple of years, but this person knew better than people who had 60 years experience. And that was what? A stronghold to keep him from receiving what the Lord was trying to do. He thought, well, I know what to do. I have experience. And unfortunately, that marriage ended in divorce. And what is the most tragic thing is that it was fixable. But because of the stronghold that was around his thinking, he wasn't able to receive the counsel from us or the counsel from the other couple. And it prevents us from knowing God. And it becomes what? That pattern of thinking that we repeat over and over and over and over again. And we can't know God because we have this wall, whether it's through unforgiveness, whether it's through bitterness, whether it's through pride. It becomes a stronghold in our lives. But the strongholds, he says those strongholds can be torn down, utterly destroyed. He says to the destruction of these strongholds, to the destruction of arguments and theories and reasonings and all of those things. It says you can overthrow them and destroy them. One of my favorite passages of scripture can be found in Proverbs 21:22. It still remains one of my favorite passages. I came across. It says, a wise person scales the city walls of the mighty. And what does that wise person do? Brings down the strongholds in which they trust. See, that got me kind of excited. It says, a wise person, an individual, has the power to assault the city walls and bring down the strongholds in which they trust. It is the destruction of that. But we can't do it in and of ourselves. They have to be empowered by what? The Spirit of God and by the Word of God. But that's what he's called us to empower us to do, to tear down those strongholds. And that's the image in which he's trying to convey to the people at Corinth. He said, you have the power to tear down that reasoning, that thinking. You can tear down their opinions, but the weapon of your warfare is not what you think or what you say. The weapon of your warfare can only be found in the Word of God. Another passage, which I kind of like adopted for myself, but is Isaiah 25, verses 11 through 12. Now, this is, it says they, and what it's referring to is the Moabites. These were the enemies of Israel, will stretch out their hands in it, and as swimmers stretch out their hands to swim, God will bring down their pride despite the cleverness of their hands. Verse 12, God, will bring down your high fortified, what? Walls. And lay them low, he will bring them down to the ground, to the very dust. And this is what he is saying, that you have the power to bring down that reasoning, to bring down that what people might think. But sometimes what we try to do is we try to reason with reason. We said, okay, then I have an opinion. I'm going to bring my opinion to bear. And all you end up with is an argument. And when you're in an argument, guess what? Walls are up. You don't want to hear what the other person has to say, especially in marriage. and marriage. You ever get into an argument with your spouse? What happens? You argue, and what happens? You bring up a wall. And you're just waiting for them to shut up so you can give them your reasoning, your thought, what you think, because you already have a wall up. So arguing doesn't do it. And sometimes we want to bring our reasoning, our intellect into bear. But what does he say? The weapons of our warfare are mighty to the tearing down all strongholds. They are mighty through the Lord. But what is the starting point? Where do I begin this tearing down of the wall? I think it begins by humbling ourselves before the Lord, turning away from our sin and trusting in him by having the Holy Spirit live on the inside of us. And those who are in Christ, guess what? We have the Holy Spirit. 2 Corinthians 3, verses 16 through 18. It says, whenever a person turns in repentance and faith to the Lord, the veil is taken away. In other words, we can see clearly that the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, what is it? There is liberty. And what does that mean? Emancipation from bondage. True freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, continually seeing as a mirror the glory of the Lord, and are progressively being what? Transformed progressively into his image from one degree of glory to even more glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. So if we're going to be effective in our tearing down of the walls, we're going to have the Holy Spirit. We're going to have the Spirit of the Lord. And the Spirit of the Lord is going to give us wisdom. As I let you know that I go to Comic-Con, I'm going this year. Yes, we are. And I have learned not to argue with folk. They'll come up to our table and want to start an argument. And I'll just say, okay. And then they want me to argue with them. Well, aren't you going to say anything? No, that's the way you feel. And they're amazed. Then they begin to ask me questions. And then when they begin to ask me questions, guess what? When they ask me questions, the walls come down. But I have to pray. I have to intercede. I have to know that I can't argue with them with my own reasoning. Whatever I say to them has to be empowered by God's Holy Spirit. And it is God's Holy Spirit that takes a hold of them and begins to minister to them. And they will I've had people talk to me for over an hour. And at the end of the hour, after we exchange, they said, you know, I like talking to you. Why? They don't know it. But the Spirit of the Lord has been ministering to them. Because if I try to argue with them, we're not going to get anywhere. But if I come in with the Spirit of the Lord, knowing that he is at work, then I can expect the strongholds to be torn down. Now, the other thing that I need in order to tear down strongholds is I have to have the Scriptures. I have to have the Word of God. I have to have the Spirit of God, and I have to have the Word of God in order to tear down the strongholds. That's the beginning of it. 2 Timothy 3:16 out of the Amplified says this: every scripture is God-breathed, given by his inspiration, and profitable for instruction, for reproof, and conviction of sin, for correction of error, and discipline in obedience, and for training in righteousness, in holy living, in conformity to God's will in thought, purpose, and action. Psalm 119:05, one of our favorite passages of Scripture says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path, the way in which I walk. And so, what is essential for the tearing down of the strongholds is first, the Spirit of the Lord and the Word of the Lord. Those are going to be, what, your weapons to tearing down the strongholds. And what are those strongholds? What they think, what they reason, what they kind of come up with their own intellect. But that's no match to the Spirit of the Lord. But those are the weapons that we have to apply to the tearing down of the strongholds. But also, we need discernment when we're going to be tearing down those strongholds. And I want to give you a specific passage of scripture that talks about how we need to be discerning. Now, this is Psalm 42, starting with verse 9. It reads like this. This is David. "For I will say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of my enemy? As with a breaking of my bones, my enemies reproach me, while they say to me all day long, where is your God? Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God." So first thing that David talks to, he says, "I will say to God, my rock." Now, what is he saying to God, my rock? What is he telling him? "Why have you forgotten me?" That's the first thing he tells him. He's telling the Almighty, all-knowing, ever-present God, the God who knows everything. He said, "Have you forgotten something? Have you forgotten me?" What that tells me is that sometimes we just have to be real before God, because we have to be real before God in order us to identify the stronghold. Because God may reveal, okay, you have a stronghold of bitterness. If I'm not receptive of it, then I'm not going to receive it. But I have to be real. I have to say, God, this is my issue. My children and my family still continues to tell me that I'm stubborn. I haven't received it yet. Okay, that's my stronghold. I don't want to receive. I don't want to know that I'm stubborn. But they say that I am, and they love me, so they must be right. I just struggle with it. I think I'm a teddy bear. I really do. But they say that I'm stubborn. But you see how it can say a stronghold in my life. Now, and he's saying to the Lord, he's saying, God, you've forgotten me. He has to be real. And so if we're going to be dealing with the stronghold in our life, we have to be real with God. We have to say, God, I have an issue with you. Or God, you didn't come through the way I thought you would come through. You have forgotten me. And you notice God didn't strike him down. Why? Because you can have that conversation with him. You can dialogue with the Lord. And he kept it real. But then what else did he say? There's an enemy that is oppressing him, and this enemy is causing him distress. Then David says this, "Why are you cast down, O my soul, or why are you bowed down?" Who's he talking to now? He's talking to himself. First he talks to God. Now he's talking to himself. He says, "My soul is cast down. My soul is bowed down. And if I'm going to receive any help, it's going to be from the Lord." In one translation, it says, "He's the health of my countenance." In other words, he brings illumination and clarity. And so what does God say about us? He's talking to what? Himself. He's encouraging himself because he's speaking to himself. He says, "My soul, why are you bowed down?" One translation says this when it talks about in the psalm. It says this, "Hope in God, since I will praise him again before being my Savior and God." Another translation says, "For I know and I shall again have plenty of reason to praise him for all that he will do." So the weapons of our warfare, I think one of the weapons that we can use is praising the Lord. And praising the Lord continually. Praising the Lord continually. Because you'll notice that first of all, he's talking about how the enemy is oppressing them. But he says, "I said, why are you downcast? I'm going to determine to praise the Lord." He's speaking to himself. And sometimes we got to speak to ourselves. And if it's going to be effective, see, the world is trying to conform us into its image. But God wants to transform us. And some of that transforming means that we have to talk. Now, you notice that when he's talking, is he rebuking the devil? Nope. Is he dealing with that a spirit of a fear? Who's he talking to? He's talking to himself. He says, my soul. There was no spiritual oppression. He says, this is between me. I need to speak to myself. I need to speak what God speaks over me, because it's my soul that is being oppressed. The spirit, there's no spirit that is involved with it. Sometimes what we see, the thing about it is what we have to do. Sometimes the strategies that we use in our spiritual warfare are different than the strategies as it concerns to our soul. And so what David's saying, the issue here is not that I'm being the spirit. The issue is that my soul is downcast. And so what I'm going to determine to do is I'm going to determine to praise the Lord, and I'm going to determine to praise the Lord continually, even though the enemy is oppressing me, even though things haven't changed. If I'm going to break down this stronghold of being bowed down, I'm going to pray, I'm going to say what God says. And I have to speak what the Lord says. You'll notice that a familiar story is the walls of Jericho. What did they do? They blew trumpets and they shouted. And what did they say? The Lord has given you the city. They were speaking it. And what we know what happened, what the walls came tumbling down by what they said. Now take note. Take note. The wall came tumbling down. And the people of God came in, and they dealt severely with the enemy. And the walls came in. They just dealt with them severely. But it didn't happen until the walls came down. So it wasn't until the walls came down were they able to come in and take captive the possessions of what the enemy had. Makes me think like this, that maybe in order for us to take captive the thoughts that run rampant in our mind, we have to tear down the strongholds. And what are those strongholds? Our reasoning, our theories, our ideas, the thinking that comes down. And they did it with the Spirit of the Lord. Now, you notice, remember, when they walked around Jericho, did they do it one time? Nope. Did they do it twice? Nope. Did they do it three times? Nope. They did it seven times, which means that it had to be continual if the walls were going to come crumbling down. And so if we're addressing a stronghold, that our praise has to be continual if the stronghold is going to come down in our life. And we're dealing with what? Our thinking, what we think, my theory is. It doesn't, there was this wrestler called The Rock, and somebody would come in and say something. He says, it doesn't matter what you think. All that matters is what the word of the Lord says. Because it is the word of the Lord that is going to be tearing down the stronghold, and it's a continual effort. And again, he's not rebuking it. He's not rebuking a spirit. He's speaking to the soul. Because sometimes the soul is different than the spirit. There was no spiritual oppression here. Again, he did not rebuke any spirit. He did not rebuke the devil. And there was a time when I think it was Saul, and he was oppressed by an evil spirit. And what did they do? What did David do? He played a song to calm, deal with the spirit. But in this case, he's speaking to himself, and he's speaking the praises of God, that he will be his help. So the thing that we have is, since he's dealing with his soul and he's encouraging himself by what he speaks, the question is, what are we speaking to ourselves? What are we speaking over ourselves? Are we speaking things over ourselves that are tearing down the stronghold? Or are we speaking things over ourselves that are building up the stronghold? And are we entertaining thoughts that are building up the stronghold? Or are we entertaining thoughts that are tearing down the strongholds? And it begins by speaking it. Again, this is out of the book of Ralph. I think in the things that I say and the things that I do, I think it says that the Lord delights in them. But then there could be things that I say and things that I do that grieve the Lord. But who says them? Those are the essentials. So we have to look at ourselves and we have to take a really examination over ourselves. What am I speaking? Am I speaking something over myself that grieves the Lord? Or am I speaking something over myself that delights the Lord? Am I speaking defeat? Am I speaking negativity? Am I speaking gossip? Am I speaking what the world says about me? And I believe the Lord said, no, I have so much more for you. I have this path for you that if you walk down it, yes, you will stumble. Yes, you will face opposition, but it is a path that will be pleasing to you, to me, and it'll be a path that I delight in. Don't say what the world says about you. That grieves my heart. But when you begin to say what I say about you, then I delight in what you say. I take joy in what you speak because you're speaking my word. And, you know, as parents, when we see our children speaking negativity over their life, what does that bring us, grief or joy? Brings us grief because we know that there is so much more that God has for them. But what we have to try to do, what we have to try to train ourselves to do, is speak what God says about us. Yes, I am forgiven. Yes, I am more than a conqueror. Yes, I am victorious. Yes, I am forgiven. Yes, I have this path that I am walking in, and I am pleasing the Lord with what I am doing. And for me, that was a hard concept to accept. I knew that God loved me, but to know that I am pleasing God, that just took my appreciation to another level. And it was based on what? Walking in his path that he delights. And that's all it takes is the word of the Lord to speak over ourselves. So we have to look at ourselves and examine what are we saying over our lives. What are we speaking over our lives? Is it something in which would grieve God? Because he says, I have so much more for you. And what you're saying is taking you down a path that is not what I have for you. You are grieving me. But when I speak a promise of the Lord, when I speak his word over my life, I just imagine the Lord says, Hercules, Hercules, Hercules. He's just delighting in what I am speaking because I'm speaking forth his word. And no matter what the enemy might bring against me, I will say, and my soul might be downcast and it may be bowed down, but I will cry out and say, the Lord is my strength. He is my song. He is my joy. Great is the Lord. He is faithful to me. Even when I'm not faithful to myself, he is faithful to his promise, faithful to intercede for me, faithful to intercede for you. And that is what I speak. And that is taking me down a path that he has for me. But again, remember one of the essentials? The Holy Spirit. Jesus says this about the Holy Spirit in John 14, 16 through 17. He says, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper. And this is out the Amplified. I like the Amplified. What is that helper? A comforter. Say that with me. Comforter. Advocate. Intercessor. Counselor. Strengthener. Stand by. To be with you forever. The Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive and take to its heart because it does not see him or know him. But you know him. Because he, the Holy Spirit, remains with you, what? Continually, and will be what? In you. See, this is what we have on the inside of us. So we have one who is our advocate, who is our comforter, who is our intercessor, who is our counselor, who strengthens us and stands by us. And so when we find ourselves, when we find our soul being bowed down, maybe we can speak this scripture over our lives to say to my soul, the Holy Spirit is living on the inside of me. The Holy Spirit is my helper. The Holy Spirit is my comforter. The Holy Spirit is my advocate. The Holy Spirit is my intercessor. The Holy Spirit is my counselor. The Holy Spirit is my strengthener. The Holy Spirit stands by me. And that is who lives on the inside of me. So why are you downcast, all my soul? Why are you bowed down? Because the Spirit of the Lord lives on the inside of you. And that is what we speak over ourselves when our soul is downcast. But again, the world can't receive the Holy Spirit, can they? The only way they can receive the Holy Spirit is by receiving Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And that is the essential. We can't be effective in tearing down the strongholds without the Word of God and without the Spirit of the Lord. Jesus says this. He says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. For us to receive this Spirit of truth, we have to receive the truth, who is Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life. So if you're watching me on Facebook or if you're watching me on YouTube and you're having the enemy has bound you up, he has shackled you with a stronghold of depression or doubt or fear, in order to deal with that stronghold, you have to have the Spirit of the Lord. And in order to receive the Spirit of the Lord, you have to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And if you've never done that and you want to make that confession of faith, I want you to pray with me and I want you to repeat with me as we pray and as we bring this before the Lord. And just repeat after me. I recognize my need of the Savior. I believe that Jesus Christ died for the forgiveness of my sins. I confess my sins. I ask the Lord to forgive me of my sins. I confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in my heart God raised Jesus from the dead. I receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I ask to be filled with your precious Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. If you have made that confession of faith, you are now born again. And you now have the Spirit of the Lord living on the inside of you. You have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you and continually with you. And he wants you to walk down this path because he does have a plan. He does have a purpose for you. And it is a glorious plan. It is a glorious purpose. And not without hills and valleys. But it says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. And that is what he wants you to experience in your life. And I want to pray with you. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the privilege that your Spirit lives on the inside of us. It dwells within us. It speaks to us. It guides us. We thank you for your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And that you would guide us into all truth. You would guide us in the path that you have for us. And yes, we will stumble, and yes, we will definitely make mistakes. But we thank you for the blood of Jesus, that as we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and you hold us up and you strengthen us and you walk with us on this journey that leads into a deeper relationship with you. Father, continue to give us insight as to how we can continually just speak to our soul and tear down strongholds. And this we just give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, I'd like to, if those of you out there and you don't have a church home, I'd like to invite you to La Mirada Forest Square Church. It is a good church. Yeah, I am so thankful to be a part of this church. But if you don't have a church, you can't come here, find somewhere where you can plant yourself. Find somewhere where you can grow in the things of the Lord. And next week, we're just going to continue on with, I'm just feeling precious to stay with this issue of strongholds. How do we deal with them? Because there are other type of strongholds. There are strongholds, how you dealt with it with the soul. But when there's a spiritual stronghold, that's a totally different strategy. And so I'm excited about just delving off into it so that we can tear down any stronghold in our thinking that would keep us from the knowledge of the Lord. And I'm going to read out of Hebrews 13, 20 through 21. It says, "Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, that is, Jesus our Lord, equip you in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen." Well, Amanda, now to you.
Praise God. Amen. Amen. Everyone awake? Praise God. Amen. There you go. All right. For July 2nd, can you believe it already? We'll be having prayer Monday and Wednesday mornings here at the church, 6 a.m. until. If you can't make it out here, just continue to be in prayer in your home or your work or wherever you're at. It doesn't matter. God hears us wherever we're at. There will be Bible study Wednesday night here at the church. 7 p.m. We are studying the book of James. Lots of good stuff in there. Come out and join us if you can. And we will be having our Spanish service actually at the Harvest tonight over in Anaheim. See us, Pastor Sam and myself, later for more details. We will be having our pot blessing outside for lunch after church. Please join us for that if you can. It's a good time of fellowship and getting to know each other a little bit in Christ. And with that, it is offering time! Dear Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you for this wonderful, beautiful day you've blessed us with. Thank you for our health. Thank you for our families. Thank you for the freedom that you've given us in Christ, Lord. We just thank you for a clear mind and for helping us to be the people you need us to be to reach out to the lost in this world, Lord. We just give you all the glory, all the praise, and all the thanksgiving, and all the joy, Lord, that you give us, Lord. In Jesus' precious holy name, amen. Amen. You are dismissed.